Hey, good afternoon, and welcome to the Al Mccray Show. My name is Jarvis El-Amin, sitting in for Al Mccray. I'm an entrepreneur, community organizer, and the co-host of Honest Opinion, urban contemporary radio station talk show. Excited to be here, and we have a variety of exciting guests with you. We have with us today, we have Mr. Russ Patterson, who is a candidate for state representative District 60. Welcome to the show, Russ.
Thank you, Jarvis. It's really good to see you again. We've known each other for quite some time, it seems.
Thank you. And also we have with us, this is my new best friend. I'm always excited to see her. She's the proponent for the county mayor. We have Ms. Marianne Stiles. Good afternoon, Mary. Welcome to the show.
Good afternoon, Jarvis, and I'm glad to have you as my new best friend.
Thank you. Also, we have Chris Cato, who's also a candidate for District 60, a young brother who's well-educated and understands how to get herself around in the political arena. We really appreciate having you and having a young, fresh perspective here. Welcome to the show, Chris.
Thank you, Jarvis. It's a pleasure to be here on the Al Mccray Show. Look forward to exciting the roundtable today.
Good. Also, we have one of my real, oh my God, I don't even know how to introduce her, but she's one of my political friends, and we talk strategy. We've probably been talking political strategy for 10 years now.
Oh, easily.
Easily, right? And she's a political strategist, political consultant, and she's the campaign manager for Russ, my dear friend, Ella Coffey. Welcome to the show, Ella.
Thank you so much. Great to be here with you, Jarvis.
And we had so much fun during the Obama thing. How much fun did we have during that run?
Had a great time.
And when I see you, I think about all those days, the sacrifices we made, but we got it done.
We did,
and I'm glad to have you.
It's about getting people out to vote.
Yes, and that's what we want to do. And on that note, why don't we go ahead and say that the primary election, we need people to come out. The pundits are saying it's going to be a low voter turnout, but we need to change that. August 24th, the same day school open, it's a primary. And some people that don't have a candidate on the other side may not have a Republican or Democrat candidate. It's going to be a universal primary, which means it'll be decided that particular day. We need you to go out and vote. You need to be involved, you need to be educated, you need to go to the political forums, to the debates, you need to be watching the TV. Your vote is your voice, and if you don't vote, you don't count. It's just that simple. It's just that simple. So we just need to keep that going and get out and vote. I also want to say where we are today. Come on over here to Rose Saxon. I tell you something, this place is urban culinary cuisine. This is the entrepreneur and the owner. She is so marketing, she's a marketing genius. But let me tell you something, the food is excellent. I go out in my spare time and I promote her. She has jazz, she has guitar, she has singing on Friday night, and you have a lecture series the last Saturday of the month where the chef talk about the sensuous size of food. You don't want to miss it. Come, it's a small investment of $20. Bring your girlfriend, bring your wife, and have some fun and rolls.
Yes.
And the food go good with it, right?
Absolutely.
And we're going to show them how to open up a banana in a sensuous way.
Absolutely. Learn a few foods from a totally sensual perspective.
Oh.
Can't miss it.
Can't miss it. It's going to be this coming Saturday. Mm-hmm. It's about 6. What time does it start?
10 p.m. for adults only. Got to be 21 and over coming.
That's right, because it's going to get hot up in there. X-rated. But we're glad to be at Urban Culinary Cuisine here in New Tampa. This is soul food at its best. And
absolutely,
we have our chef who has been cooking all over the world. He make it to your taste buds. Says, oh my God, curl. That's it. Thank you for allowing us to be here.
Thank you very much.
All right, we got some topics. I want to jump off with some real serious topics here. One I want to talk about the appointment of Curtis Stokes. This is near and dear to my heart, to the city council, and the effect that it's going to have on city council chair Tom Scott as he prepares to run for mayor. First of all, Curtis Stokes' record of community service is terrible in the African-American community. When he was at the NAACP, he really did never get it done. He also headed up the minority African-American participation in getting money from the Super Bowl. And I don't know nobody, African-American small business, that can tell me they got no money. He has been involved in the Super Bowl. So it looked like it was a wrap. It was a dog and pony show. It looked like that Scott and Joe Catano and Mary Murhern had made a deal that if you help me get my person, which was Curtis Stokes, and then Murhern got Jolie Capine. So everybody know that whole setup. They've been friends for many, many years. Let's talk about it. Now, Curtis Stokes, 9 investment properties of Marianne in foreclosure. He's a banker. He's the vice president of community affairs for Fifth Third Bank. How is it going to play with the tough economic times, the budget, $724 million budget? How are we going to trust this man with that big a budget as a public trust and can't even handle his own affairs?
Well, Jarvis, you have to look at where we are today in our economy. And a lot of people I know went into commercial deals and they've gone bankrupt. And I don't know enough about to know, I don't know Curtis that well either. I know him, but not that well, to know if it was because he got caught up in a situation he couldn't control or if he made bad decisions that resulted in where he is today. So it's difficult for me to be critical because I have clients that's got difficulties too with the same situation. This economy is really hurting Tampa.
Yeah, and I can appreciate that, Marianne, and you gave a good political answer, and I really appreciate it. But this is a question of judgment, and those problems was investment problems. I mean, you know, I'm fighting foreclosure for my own house and getting a loan modification, make home affordable. So everybody, you know, I have no problem with that. But you knew, Tom Scott knew. He knew he ran for mayor. He knew that if he chose Curtis, he's going to have to give a financial disclosure. You know, and me, if I was a chairman of the city council and I'm running for mayor, I'm a vet, the person that I'm talking about raising my hands in support. For city council, but that's going to the budget coming up, minority business, African American got less than 1% of business with the city. That's something that we needed a warrior, a black organizer, a black activist that can really go after it for these 8 months. And I think
there's no question that there were other qualified candidates that would not have had that problem. And if he did have that problem and didn't disclose to Commissioner Scott, I think that would be a problem.
And I think that is.
I think the whole issue is that the selection process for the city council is not quite right for that type of event. You know, they need to, people that are applying for the job, the city council should have required them to do a financial disclosure before the application rather than after the appointment, because in my particular election, everybody that's running who qualifies for office has got to give a financial disclosure.
That's right, and you're right, and Tom Scott came back after it was over saying it was a change of process, but you know, chickens came on the roost on that. Ellis, you know I got to come to you on that because you in the hood, you're a community organizer as I am, and you know if we was on the corner, we'd be kicking the political consequences of this.
Here's my only statement I say about that. We as a community have got to start holding our elected officials and our community activists to the fire. You made a comment that Mr. Stokes hasn't necessarily done anything for our community. We have got to do better with choosing who are our leaders. I don't have anything to say either way with Mr. Stokes relative to his foreclosure, because in my opinion, that's personal. If I know that he's obviously still making great decisions for Fifth Third Bank because he's still employed, so I hope that he will take the business side of him and move it over to the city council and able to help make some decisions there. But when it comes to the business that's not being done with the black businesses in town, we've got to hold the top person accountable. Well, the top cop in that aspect is the mayor. Yeah, she can make those changes.
Well, you're exactly right. And then we do have a minority business manager, some brother, I think Gregory Hart. And it's just unacceptable to have, we to be 13% of the population, get less than 0.5% of the business that's sitting to business with. Chris, tell me about it. I mean, Curtis Stokes, how you think he'll do?
My take on it is this. As Ella said, it's a personal matter, but governments run by human beings. So all you got to go on is the person and how they handle themselves. It's not like he's your average person, you know, coming out of the hood who is struggling, who only has a home that is modification. These are investment properties. These are business decisions from a banker. So you mean to tell me that someone whose background they were chosen because of their business background is making bad investments? I mean, how's it going to go when he's investing the city's money?
Well, you know what, Kato, you knocked a home run on that. You hit it right where I thought it was. And I tell you, that's how I look at it. And his record of community service in the community have not been good. So I told him, time will tell. We'll be watching. Thank you.
Time will tell.